All right, hey there, folks. Even though convention signings and other live events are back on track, I figured I'd keep bringing Book Tour to you. So, welcome to Russ's Rock and Roller Coaster, intriguing interviews with creative minds. Well, we love our crime fiction on the roller coaster, and we especially love to hear from current and former law enforcement officers, say that three times fast, who report back from the front line. So please welcome tonight's guest, J. Todd Scott. J. Todd is an active DEA agent investigating international maritime smuggling, domestic meth labs, and Mexican cartels. And while he's not hunting down criminals, he's an author of intense crime thrillers. Welcome, J. Todd.
Hey, how are you? Thanks for having me.
All right, good to see you. All right, just a quick heads up to the folks at home. Feel free to send me any notes or questions you have for J. Todd in the chat box during the show, and we'll get to a few at the end. Okay, Todd, as we always do, we'll start at the beginning. Where were you born and where'd you grow up?
I was born in Paducah, Kentucky, and I grew up in Louisville, Kentucky. So basically Western and Central Kentucky, to actually where I live now. I moved back home not long ago. I still have family all over the state.
All right. So when you were growing up, what was it? Was it just you? Did you have brothers, sisters? What was the lineup?
You know, I had a very traditional family. My mother, my father, I have one sister. She's 7 years younger than me. She lives here in Kentucky as well. She's married and got a couple of sons. And, you know, we had kind of a traditional upbringing here in the state, public schools. Spent my summers riding bikes, shooting basketball, running around kind of in the neighborhood, and then went off to college and law school. Okay.
All right, whoa, slow it down, Chief, slow it down. You're skipping over all the good stuff. So, all right, so you're out in Kentucky, it's you and your sister. So 7 years, so I've got two sisters who, right. they are actually twins, they're 4 years younger than me, but we were just kind of close enough where we still kind of interacted, but 7 years is a little bit of a gap. Did you guys, was it enough where it was sort of like, you know, you kind of, you just operated in different circles socially?
I mean, a little bit. Yeah. I mean, I was away at college by the time she was going through high school and stuff. So, you know, I was, an active presence in her life. And, you know, we've gotten closer since I've moved back home. But, you know, I was more the big brother and the babysitter, yeah. You know, than I would say best friends at the time that we were growing up. And we just, the age difference was just too great. But, you know, she was a good little sister, still is.
All right, nice. So what was it like you were a kid? And so you said, you know, you played some basketball, you're outside, but you know, what else kept you busy? Did you have were you a reader? Were you a sports kid? Were you what was your thing?
I mean, I was sports aspirational, like I wanted to be a sports kid, but you know, that requires being tall and fast, and I really wasn't any of those things. I was definitely a reader from a very young age. You know, I'd say reading and writing were hobbies of mine for basically as long as I could remember and occupied a good chunk of my time.
What were you reading? What were you into?
Oh, I was very much into science fiction and fantasy at that age. You know, Stephen King and Michael Crichton and, you know, basically anything I could get my hands on. My mother would take me to the library basically every couple of weeks. You know, we'd go to our local library. I had free reign of the place. I could check out as many books as I wanted, take them home, knock them out, basically any genre that I wanted. My family were all big readers, so they instilled that in me early. Wow. And so yeah, you know, movies, that was kind of showing my age. That was when the video stores kind of first started, Betamax and VHS. I worked at a video store.
Oh, yeah, me too.
Yeah, so I worked at a movie theater. So okay. I would say very much that sort of reading, writing, games, all that sort of stuff was kind of a big part of my growing up.
So were you like a Star Wars guy or Star Trek kid? Were you a Spielberg kid? Like,
I can remember watching Star Trek with my dad. And I was probably more Star Wars than Star Trek at the time, but I can remember watching the original series with my dad. Obviously, I can remember going to the Star Wars movies and having all of the action figures in the lunchbox and trading cards. I was really big into the Star Wars trading cards. I mean, you know, all that stuff. I loved Close Encounters of the Third Kind. I loved Jaws.
Yes.
You know, those were formative movies for me. Raiders of the Lost Ark, obviously. But probably once I saw Blade Runner, that was my idea of science fiction. Blade Runner and Alien were probably more formative for me on the sci-fi side than even Star Trek and Star Wars.
So you liked more the darker, more intense kind of sci-fi?
Yeah, I liked the atmospherics, right? I liked that sci-fi that posited a future that maybe wasn't so bright and shiny. The kind of banged up and dented future of Blade Runner and Alien appealed to me. Also, the somewhat, particularly on Alien, the kind of horror touchstones that movie had. And they were just visually impressive. I mean, they created worlds that felt very immersive in a way that, some of the other stuff didn't. Star Trek to me felt like a set. I love the stories and I love the characters, but it felt like I was watching a movie, or a TV show or a set. Right. You know, the minute you strap in and watch Blade Runner or Alien, it just felt completely different to me.
For sure. And especially coming out of especially the let's call it like the Spielberg stuff, which I love then, still love now. But that was sort of a little bit more, it was brighter, more adventure, a little more aspirational. And then you kind of got into that, the world's not always so shiny.
Yeah. The world's a lot of gray, a lot of rain, stuff. Yeah. And I think that, although I haven't written sci-fi books in that vein, I think the books I do write are much more in that tone than they would have been in the Star Trek or Star Wars.
Right. So were your buddies kind of into the same kind of things as you, or were you kind of off on your own and that kind of thing?
No, not in high school. I was in the band. I don't know if that's cool or not. I was in a band,
So wait, in the band or a band?
Well, both actually. I did play in a couple of kind of bad garage bands. I was in the band as well, the marching band. So I saw a lot of sports from the grandstands where I was playing in the band. But I had a couple of a core group of friends who shared kind of my same interest, and we're still friends today. And I was kind of one of those guys that got along with everybody. I didn't have a huge peer group, but I got along with kind of everybody's group.
Well, so what kind of music were you into?
Oh, back then it was very much kind of the new age. Flock of Seagulls, Men Without Hats.
Yeah, of course.
That sort of stuff. Eurythmics, lots of keyboards.
80, good 80s pop. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, very much that sort of stuff. When I got into college, moving on a little bit, it was more kind of 80s hair bands and metal and all that sort of stuff. Okay. And was fortunate to find, again, a core group of friends in college. Yeah. And I've kind of kept these two groups of friends throughout till today. I could call up, many of them today. So,
what did your folks do?
My dad was, kind of a accounting CFO sort of guy. He's been involved in a lot of big businesses in and around here, Kentucky, professional executive, I guess. Mm-hmm. And my mother was in a very traditional model, a stay-at-home mom. And which is a tremendous amount of work in and of itself.
Oh, it sure is.
Yeah. So, we were very fortunate that she was willing and able to do that. And, she was the typical mom involved in school and our events and made sure we got stuff done. And, again, a big reader herself and still is today. She has a lot of opinions about my books, I can tell you that. So,
You're lucky. My mom doesn't read any of my nothing. No, my family doesn't read anything that I write. Okay, I've written a lot of stuff, and they don't read it.
I don't when I say I had a very traditional childhood, I mean that in the most positive way. It's not disparaging. I had a great childhood. My parents are still married. I still get along with my sister. It's interesting that given what a kind of normal childhood I had, that most of the family dynamics in my own books are all jacked up. I mean, they're very weird family dynamics, given that my own family is all still very, normal, and we all get along and didn't have any issues growing up.
You got some strange wish fulfillment going on there.
I don't know. I get asked about that a lot, like why my books are so different than my own background. And, But, you know, yeah, I was very fortunate. So,
all right. So let me ask you. So you ultimately, you went to law school.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever, and so, you know, I know lots of lawyers, lots of people who went to law school, but not all of them actually practiced. And there's, you can sort of take a law degree and do a lot of different things. When you went to law school, did you intend to practice law, or was that part of a larger strategy that you hope would play out as part of law enforcement?
No, actually, I had already kind of applied to be a federal agent and was basically waiting for that process to go through. And it was kind of dragging on for a lot of reasons at the time. So I kind of went to law school. Really, I was working in the private sector, waiting for DEA to give me a call and say, hey, it's time to come be an agent, because I'd gotten, you know, 3/4 of the way through the process. And it was taking a little bit of time. And I thought I would use that time to knock out a law degree in the meantime. So my plan always was to do federal law enforcement. I was kind of well down that track, and kind of went to law school as I was waiting for that track to finish up for me.
Okay. So there are various branches of law enforcement. What specifically drew you to the DEA?
The movie Lethal Weapon. And I know that sounds weird because Lethal Weapon isn't about, you know, drugs.
Right.
Per se.
Right.
Lethal Weapon and Miami Vice, because it looked to be like this coolest sort of law enforcement that you could do. You didn't have to wear a uniform. You got to grow your hair long. At least on TV, you got to drive fast or maybe live on a boat. I would like to say it was something more mature than that.
He's like, hey, honestly, I just wanted to look cool.
I just thought it would be kind of badass to do that. And you know, I'd met a few different federal agents, and you know, FBI guys were real nice, and Secret Service guys, you know, their job didn't look like a whole lot of fun sitting around hotel rooms. And the narcs that I met, the DEA guys, just seemed kind of cooler and tougher. And, you know, they all had beards and they all smoked. I've never smoked, but, you know, they just kind of all seemed like they just did their own thing. And that was so far removed from my own experience growing up.
Right.
You know, I really wanted to see if I, you know, could cut it, if I had what it took to do that sort of career. So I picked the most unobvious thing I could think of and went to go do that.
So when you go into the DEA, I mean, I know I've spoken to, you know, many, you know, law enforcement officers or former over the years. And but I'm just curious, what kind of training specifically goes into being a DEA agent that's sort of maybe different from just being, you know, if you were in, I don't know, the FBI or the CIA, or just being, you know, part of a police department or the sheriff's department?
Well, it's interesting. When I went through the DEA Academy, we actually shared the same facilities as the FBI. So the different floors of the Academy, you had FBI agents on a couple floors, then DEA agents, then FBI agents. We shared the same ranges, you know, shooting ranges. If you watch Silence of the Lambs, that kind of film that Jodie Foster's running around, we did that. So the training was a little more similar and actually co-located back in when I went through, at least DEA and FBI.
Is that in Arlington?
Down in Quantico.
Oh, Quantico, that's what I meant.
Yeah,
sorry,
right. Quantico. And since then, we now have our own you know, training facility. We share some of the same still firing ranges and some practical buildings, but otherwise we have our own units. And, you know, the difference I think with DEA, at least I could compare to the FBI at the time, is we were much more militaristic. I mean, we wore BDUs, we shaved our heads. You know,
BDU, what's that?
You know, like a combat dress, like military fatigues, right?
Got it.
You know, they were in button downs and khakis, and you know, we looked like we had just, you know, jumped out of a helicopter. And
so basically, you looked like you were part of the SWAT team.
Yeah, exactly. Then we got yelled at a lot more, I think. you know, it was just kind of a different program, and there was a lot of emphasis on undercover and drug ID surveillance, practical applications. You know, obviously undercover played a big part of what they taught us back then. I really hadn't shot any weapons before. The only guns I shot were the ones the DEA taught me how to shoot, and a lot of, you know, physical hand-to-hand sort of combat and all that sort of stuff. So it's very kind of a militaristic sort of training for someone like me who'd never been through that. I mean, you had your law classes and writing classes, but a lot of it was running and jumping and shooting and fighting and wrecking cars and things. And that's still pretty much what the training is like now. And, you know, again, I don't want to disparage my FBI friends. I got a lot of them and a lot of ATF friends and the other acronym agencies. But when I was going through, our program felt so much different than the other guys I knew who were going through different agencies at the time.
It seems like a much more visceral training. Yes. Right. So, right. So let me ask you, so at least up until, and we'll get into what it was like to be in the field, but from the moment when you said, okay, I want to join the DEA, and you went through that, you probably had some idea of what you thought it was going to be like. Did it turn out to be what you thought? Was it very different? Was it similar? What happened there?
It was exactly what I thought it would be in all the best ways.
Okay. Right?
I didn't feel like I got sold a bill of goods. I didn't feel like what was on the train, you know, the training video or the recruitment video was any different.
Enjoy this palatial spa looking over the Hawaiian Ocean.
they were pretty blunt with me about what was going to happen and what my life was going to be like. And it pretty much followed true to script.
Right.
But in all the ways that I would have wanted it to. I mean, I've had a fantastic career. I've had to do everything I could have imagined.
Well, we're going to talk all about that.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this, you know, since it's such a physical role, and, you know, at any point when you were in this, did you say, good Lord, what did I get myself into? I don't know if I'm cut out for this. Or did you say, you know what, this shit's awesome?
I said both. really, honestly, going through the training, we did we had to do this boxing training that we went through. And boxing's really hard. Fighting is kind of easy, but boxing is hard. And winning is the hardest thing of all. And so they put you in this ring and you fight and you box these guys. And I'm not a very good boxer at all, but I am a good fighter. I'm a pretty good scrapper and I can take a beating like nobody's business. But I was like, man, if I'm gonna have to box people throughout my career, we're gonna have a real problem. I'm gonna get my clock cleaned. But it was a challenge. It was the challenge that I wanted and I think I needed, because again, I'd had a pretty routine, you know, childhood and, you know, college career. And so to be tested that way, physically, mentally, you know, to go through the stress of learning how to do undercover and all that, I wanted to know if I could do it. And, you know, I guess I proved that I could. So,
you tackle some pretty insane, I mean, it sounds like you have and still do and tackle some pretty intense cases. Talk to me, what's a day in the life for you?
Well, my day now is different because I'm kind of a supervisor. But, you know, when I was a brand new agent out in L.A., really you show up and you got a badge and you got a gun and they give you a car and you got to go find drug dealers and you got to go arrest drug dealers. And that, you know, you're talking to informants, you're doing undercover, you know, informants are doing introductions with you. So you're meeting bad guys and maybe you're meeting on a boat or meeting in a bar or meeting in a park somewhere. You're buying dope or you're pretending to sell dope or you're pretending to be a money launderer.
So that was actually, you were actually doing that undercover?
Yeah, doing those things. And I'm not, you know, I think the thing you learn about undercover is it's less about what you look like. I mean, I'm not a tall guy. I'm not imposing that way. But if you can bullshit
right,
and you can be comfortable, right, and you can kind of fit in, then you can basically buy dope or sell dope to about anyone. Right. And, you know, I that stuff didn't make me nervous and I could bullshit with the best of them. So, I was good at undercover. Not everybody likes it. Not everybody's good at it, but it didn't. I was good at it. I was good at working with informants, you know, spending a lot of time with informants and managing and dealing with them. So, about the things you would see on on Miami Vice, those are the sorts of things we were doing and we were doing
So you were in. So you said you started in L.A.
Los Angeles, yeah.
Okay, right. Obviously, you know, this probably, I'm just assuming, but, you know, because there's a huge ports out there, you know, a lot of drugs being smuggled in. So there was a lot, I'm guessing, right, there was a lot of that sort of, you know, checking, you know, cargo containers and seeing how,
you had the ports out there. So I was involved in some of that, but you also had a big gang problem in the early mid 90s when I was out there. Mm-hmm. That was when the Mexican cartels were really starting to come into their own. Right. So you had drugs coming over the border south of LA proper, and dope was leaving LA about every way imaginable on trucks and planes and everything else. You still had massive marijuana grows in the national forest out there. So you still had a lot of Asian gangs that were bringing in heroin at that time. So about, you know, when I got on the job, said a lot of Colombians still living in LA and doing Colombian with Colombian cartels. So I had a kind of a massive, you know, on the job training and experience right away by starting in a huge, huge city like that. And about every sort of dope case or dope that we could work, I worked during my time out there.
Did you, I don't know if you saw it. I just finished watching. Did you see Snowfall?
No, I heard about it. I have not seen it.
It's incredible. It's great. Just curious, by the time you were there, had the kind of the crack cocaine, like the real explosion, had it already passed? Or
it had pretty much already passed at that time. You know, I mean, obviously we were still seeing the tail end of it there. And in the gang cases we were working, a lot of crack cocaine was involved there. But really what I kind of got caught up in when I first got out to LA was the rise of the Mexican cartels. That was a big thing. Chapo and all of those others, the Colombian cartels had just kind of ceded a lot of that territory. The southwest border was taken over by the Mexican cartels, and so that's what I spent a lot of my time, and that was big dope. I mean, that was, you know, 100 keys of coke at a time or more. So that's the sort of cases that we were working.
So who would you say, I mean, broadly speaking, there are no, you know, good cartels, but was there one in particular or one group that you had to dealt with who you thought, God, these are guys, they're the worst of the worst. These guys are just animals.
By the time I transitioned over to El Paso, for instance, we were dealing with a lot of, we're dealing with the Zetas and still the Sinaloa cartel. You know, nowadays it really is a Sinaloa cartel and Jalisco New Generation or the CJNG. But, you know, whatever name you slap on them, they're right. All violent. And, right. You know, and now they're all very, powerful criminal syndicates, corporations, crime right. corporations. But they were all violent. Almost didn't matter what name you slapped on them. But when I was out in L.A. at the start of my career, you know, Chapo Guzman was the big guy at that time. Right. Ariano Felix and his crew had just kind of started to recede a little bit. And it was Chapo who kind of had a stranglehold on most of what was going on at that time.
Right. So how much of your job was investigation and how much of it was guns out, putting yourself in physical danger?
You know, it depends on what you're doing. But I do tell the new agents that come on board is, you know, we're called special agents or federal agents. But actually, if you look at our credentials, in our job series, we're actually criminal investigators. And so that really is the heart of what we do. We investigate crimes, and you don't get to the guns out running around waving, you know, jumping off of cars until you do a hell of a good criminal investigation before that. So, you know, I always tell people that my job is always interesting, but it's not always exciting.
Right.
And that's kind of the way you want it to be. Right. Right. But depending on the case you're working, I mean, if you're working real street level, you know, violent criminal gangs, you're going to be waving a gun around and fighting a lot. If you're doing a more complex, longer term conspiracy, pace is going to be a little slower and it's going to be more investigation than crime.
Do you ever work a case or been in the field and you thought, I don't know if I'm going to make it out of here alive?
I spent some time overseas in a very difficult assignment in Port-au-Prince, Haiti at the time, and that really felt cut off. You're out there working with Haitian national police who aren't trained anywhere near as well as we are in very right. desperate and dangerous situations. So yeah, that was really difficult with some really violent, well-resourced, kind of corrupt gangs and criminal organizations out there. So yeah, it was a tough 2 years. I wouldn't have been quick to do that again.
Right. How much, I mean, you know, because I'm not in that world, I only know what I, you know, from what I watch on TV and I, you know, you read the news and you talk to people, how much of an issue, I mean, honestly, is the drugs and the drug money that it actually infiltrates law enforcement, where the fact that, you know, you're theoretically you're working with guys who are, you know, maybe not on the right side of things.
You know, I would say here in the States, not so much, but overseas, it is a huge problem. It really is in some of the countries that we deal with. And it's a national security problem in those countries. You know, not that we don't have corrupt agents and corrupt cops. We see that all the time. We have a lot of checks and balances in place and ways to kind of ferret that out. You know, I haven't seen it be anywhere near as rampant as TV and movies might lead you to believe, right? Where every third agent is right,
you know. Of course, right, right.
You know? Yeah, so yeah. That's, you know, it's not all training day out here.
Okay. All right. You want to go home? Right.
Yeah, exactly.
So let me ask you this. So and this is kind of it's a bigger question. And you know, you having been on the front lines of this for what, 20 years or so. So the war on drugs has cost billions and billions of dollars. And who knows how many lives directly and indirectly have been destroyed. And it doesn't seem to be getting any better. And you could argue that it's getting worse. Mm-hmm. What's your take on collectively on our efforts to fight this war on drugs? And do you think it's a war that's still worth fighting?
Well, it's not like I haven't been asked that before. And, you know, in a different conversation, longer conversation, I might take issue with the characterization of a war. But that's a shorthand that a lot of people use.
Yeah.
And look, over the last year, nearly 108,000 Americans have died from opioid overdoses.
Well, that's for sure.
You know, a epidemic of almost an unimaginable scale.
The dope sick was horrifying.
Right, exactly. And so, yeah, that begs the question of how successful we have been, and should we look at other models? You know, I definitely believe that treatment, prevention, education, a focus on mental health, substance abuse disorder, all of that needs to be part of the discussion, because, you know, it's kind of a cliche now, but we can't arrest our way out of the problem. I know that. I don't have enough agents. I don't have enough handcuffs. Mm-hmm. Right. And so some of this is a social question, like what is we as a society are willing to accept. Right. But that being said, the reality is there probably are some drugs that we're never going to legalize.
Right. And we probably shouldn't.
And so I think there will always be a role for people who do what I do, because there will always be criminals who will find, you know, those shadowy corners and work out of them. And even if we made a bunch of, you know, controlled substances legal tomorrow, these criminal syndicates are not suddenly going to go straight and open up yogurt shops and, and strip malls, right? I mean,
you're not trading in Coke for Jamba Juice.
Exactly. These are poly-drug, poly-criminal organizations.
Right.
And so there will always be a need for law enforcement to deal with these people who are really predators on us. And whether you want to call a DA agent, FBI agent, ATF agent, there's always going to be a need, I think, for someone with a badge and a gun and willing to stand on the line of law to deal with these predators who don't recognize laws at all.
Fair enough. Absolutely. All right. So we could go talking about this for hours and hours, and we don't have those hours, but we will again. So talk to me. When did you first get serious? So, which is, it's amazing that you're, as an active agent, that you're also writing crime fiction. So when did you first get serious about writing?
Well, I've been serious when I was younger, and I was serious through college, and then decided I probably couldn't make a living writing. And, you know, my other passion was law enforcement and thought that was cool. And so kind of put the writing aside and dove headfirst into the law enforcement world. But I still loved the idea of writing. I loved reading. And, you know, in law enforcement, what do? You sit around, tell stories and bullshit all the time. So, so I was bullshitting for years and years before I actually started writing seriously again. But that was You know, kind of later in my career, I was had to take some time off of the street, do a headquarters tour. It's a requirement for all of us. So I wasn't on the street doing the sort of cases and working the hours that I was kind of used to working. And it was an opportunity for me to kind of pick up the pen again. And I met some people who were working on screenplays and some novelists, and they kind of gave me the bug to get involved again. And so, you know, this was, you know, 2011, 2012, I just started writing, and I actually did the NaNoWriMo competition, if you're aware of that.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I wrote my 50,000 words in the month of November and never stopped writing after that, and kind of kept it up. So,
all right. So how much of your, you know, your DEA real life experience, whether it's just, you know, broadly or in the nuances, how much of it finds its way to the page?
I would say in the first four books, quite a bit. You know, because those are a little bit different than the book last year and the book I have coming out. So my fingerprints, my DNA, my career are all over those books. They deal with cartels, they deal with crime, they deal with the border when I was living on the border. So very little to no research went into those books other than me sitting down and remembering the work that I did and the people that I worked with.
Right, right. So just a quick interlude for the folks who came in a little late. If you have any questions or comments for Jay Todd, send them in the chat box and we'll get to a few at the end. All right. So given that, you know, you were on the front lines for so long and you're still in a supervisory position, what do you think that this is, again, you know, generally speaking, do you think that books, TV shows and movies, that they do well in translating reality to crime fiction? And what do you think they typically get wrong that really kind of drives you nuts?
I think what they get wrong is that most of the cops and agents and the, you know, people kind of protagonists in these stories are much more cavalier about the law and safety. You know, there's much more of this attitude, we'll do whatever it takes to get the job done sort of attitude. That's not, you know, it's not been my experience, right? You know, the agents and everyone I've worked with, these are professionals, and you know, upholding the law, can't uphold the law if you're out breaking the law. So that kind of cavalier attitude is not often, you know, that's over dramatized for TV right. purposes and things like that. You know, because it's work to make a criminal investigation, you got to write reports and you got to do all of those things. So
right.
I think what they get right nowadays is the tension, the danger, and how savvy criminal organizations are.
Right.
You know, they have infinite resources. And so I think they do a pretty good job of portraying the sort of hills and mountains that we have to climb.
Right. So how much of it, you know, so there's the, you know, you kind of do, you're the front end, right? You do the investigating, you know, and then ultimately, you know, if it gets there, a case has to be made, you know, a prosecutor has to kind of come in.
Right.
How much of it, again, you know, and again, distinction between reality and, you know, and fiction, how much of what you guys do on the front lines and you think, hey, look, you know, we got the bad guys, we collected our evidence, we really made a case, and then you hands it off and then they get away or they get off with what amounts to a slap on the wrist considering what was happening there. Does that happen a lot, a little, like what
really happens? It definitely happens. I mean, these... You know, we're not bounty hunters. We don't get paid more by the number of years that somebody gets put in jail or the number of people we put in jail. Mm-hmm. But definitely you could bring down a case and want to indict and arrest 20 people. And a prosecutor may say, feel that you only have a good and strong evidence on 10. Right. So you got 10 people that I know is a crook and that I feel the evidence proves is a crook. And yet a prosecutor somehow has to convince a judge and a jury that they're crooks. So, yeah, I mean, that sometimes there's a sense that, you know, we don't get all the bang for our buck. But having gone to law school and, you know, having, you know, good friends that are prosecutors, I understand that, you know, it can be difficult to prosecute even a well investigated case. Right. And, you know, you're dealing with informants. They're not necessarily reliable. You know, you have all sorts of issues when it comes to evidence, search warrants, and all the mistakes that can happen, the guys that escape, and the evidence that you don't have. Right. You know, even with wires and informants and undercover, there's still a lot of, when you take down a case, there's still a lot you don't know and people you haven't identified. So it's always should be a collaborative effort for the prosecution. And, you know, we've worked with very good prosecutors, but like, you know, like us, you know, some are better than others, some are more aggressive than others. And at the end of the day, you still have to go in front of a jury and a judge and convince them that your work was worthwhile.
So how, I'm curious about this, because the folks that you're going after, I mean, you know, this is not, you know, they're not playing checkers. I mean, this is some serious, dangerous yes. life that they're involved. How, you know, what happens there when, you know, you pick up, let's say, someone who's lower level or mid level, and I guess the idea is, right, you take him, flip him up for somebody bigger and up the chain. How much are they, do they break easily? Are they really sunk in? You know, is it just kind of every man for himself, or is it just kind of situational? Like, what happens there?
I mean, it depends. I mean, some, you know, I have met, you know, I've arrested guys who flipped immediately. Right. I mean, you know, that you've got, there's no honor among thieves. Right. And there's mercenaries. And, you know, sometimes we arrest guys who promises have been made to them, and those promises weren't upkept. And so they have an axe to grind too. Sometimes you arrest guys who are just hard ass, and they're going to stare you right in the eyes, and they're going to say, do your worst. Right. And they're going to take their hit, and they're going to take it for however long it is. And some of them are scared to death. They're more scared of the criminal organizations they work for than they're scared of us. Mm-hmm. And, you know, 15 years in a federal pen is a hell of a lot safer than being out on the streets if they flipped, you know, because they have family out there and kids out there. So it's a very ugly, violent business. And eventually they all learn that there's no honor among thieves. So, but yeah, I've seen every reaction possible.
I mean, I have to think that, you know, just the fear of just retribution against someone you love would almost be more, you know, all right, so you're gonna crack me over the head, you're gonna slit my throat or whatever, but, you know, you're gonna burn my kids alive or kill my wife or whatever else you got to do. I mean, where you have probably also the sense of not having any control of what they might do, right?
Right. And I've heard those threats. You know, I've had tape recorded conversations of those threats. And I've seen those threats carried out. I've had informants that have been injured and killed. So it is part of the work that we do. And it's part of the risks that we take and the people that we arrest take.
How does that work? So if you're, you know, you're doing your investigation and you have an informant, someone who's working with you, for you, whatever, and you put them in a situation where, you know, they have to, you know, I mean, I don't know how much of like wearing a wire is, that's how prevalent is that really? Is that a big part of what you do or not?
Yeah.
Really? Or?
Yeah. I mean, nowadays it's a little more sophisticated. When I was first doing undercover, it was just like you saw in the early 80s TV shows, literally a wire taped to your chest and you hope that the tape didn't come free and the wire didn't slip out under your shirt. Right. A little more sophisticated than that now. Yeah. But look, juries are very sophisticated. They've watched a lot of TV shows.
Right.
And, you know, right, wrong, or indifferent, they don't merely want to take the word of someone on the stand. And so there's no better evidence than audio and visual.
Right.
And so we go to great lengths to make sure that we do that. And also it's a safety thing. I mean, the ability to audio and videotape real time, our undercovers and our informants, allows us to stay involved in the action, even when we're, you know, a block or two away. So it's for evidentiary purposes, absolutely, but it's also for safety purposes as well.
I want to follow up on this thread, but I want to go back. I had one other question. So how often or what's the real threat? So you work with someone, let's say they're going to wear a wire on your behalf to get information on somebody worse or whatever it is. But how often, I mean, they got to be, I have to imagine, they got to be shitting in their pants that they're doing this. Like, how often, I mean, are they able to keep their cool? I mean, how often does it just like, just literally go bad in the room? Like, do they tip themselves off or?
Not, you know, I mean, these crooks aren't necessarily the smartest guys, right? Maybe they're not going to score real high on the SAT, but they are very savvy and they're very good at what they do.
Right.
And you don't get involved in this sort of criminal business and not be able to keep your cool pretty well.
Right.
Even when it is going to shit all around you. So I've been fortunate. I haven't had an informant absolutely go sideways in the middle of a thing. I haven't had an undercover do it either. But I have had them extract themselves, you know, because they could tell it was going bad or they could tell that they were losing control of the situation.
Right.
And, you know, that's a savvy, that's a smart undercover who knows when to pull out. And look, you know, we're going to be respectful of these guys and what they're doing when they're in that room or they're in the back of that car or, you know, they're trying to do these negotiations. And if they're going to want to get pulled out, then they're going to get pulled out.
Is there are there guardrails about, you know, you're asking someone to go into the field, right, in a dangerous setting? Are there guardrails that says, you know, this is too dangerous and this is not? Or is it just you just kind of have to feel it out in every situation?
Well, there are definitely, I mean, we have a tremendous number of policies and procedures around this and a lot of plans. I mean, we just never, you know, give a guy a cell phone and some money and kick him out of the car and say good luck.
Right.
You know, this is all highly orchestrated, you know, highly stylized. You know, it's it's kind of like a movie set in that regard, right? Mm-hmm. Everybody has a role to play. We know where everybody is. So that doesn't mean it doesn't often go sideways or you know, because the minute you get out there and start doing what you're doing, you're introducing other people in it and they may not want to do it your way. But there are a lot of, you know, it's kind of gut feeling and art in terms of reading the room and kind of knowing how it's going and that sort of stuff. But in terms of doing an operation, undercover operation, there's a lot of policies, procedures, and quite honestly, expertise and experience that comes into play and that's all brought into bear.
Right.
So, you know, we're not just throwing darts at a dartboard when we put an undercover or an informant back out on the street.
I mean, I'd have to imagine at least there's got to be some real concern about, you know, collateral damage, you know, just innocent people getting caught in the crossfire of whatever's going on, right?
Oh, sure. I mean, you know, and that's when we do our operational plans and when we do any sort of undercover meet. This idea of being out in public and public spaces and what the background is and what's going on, that factors heavily into what we do and how we do it when we're out there in any sort of enforcement operation.
Right. All right. So we were talking about some of the technology that you guys are using. So now that we are squarely in the clutches of AI, which will only grow in significance, how do you see that playing a role in law enforcement, and how far off or on point do you think that fictionalized versions of AI we've read in books and seen in movies and TV shows will actually become real?
Well, you know, I'm trying to wrap my head around the AI stuff as well. And clearly, I think we have seen, and I don't know if AI is the right word, but
Or even AI and or sort of advanced technology.
Yeah, geomapping and stuff like that. I mean, there's a lot of kind of advanced technology. 21st century law enforcement is more than just three guys with a coffee cup standing around a map.
Right.
I mean, you know, we do a lot of data collection. We do a lot of targeting. You know, DEA, we like to say that we're data driven and intel led. Right. And so that's going to be a lot of technologies and tools that didn't exist, frankly, when I started on the job,
right,
28 years ago. So I think all of that will come into play. Facial recognition technology, you know, that sort of stuff. There's a lot of evidentiary stuff that can be used.
So actually, let me ask you about that. I'm curious about the facial recognition. How sophisticated is it really?
Well, I mean, I've seen, pretty good models of it. Like I've seen pretty good technology and it's pretty, pretty useful. Right. And the ability to look at social media, for instance, and use that sort of technology to pick persons out of various social media scrubs and things like that. Again, this is, you know, and all of the cyber stuff and Bitcoin and all of this. I mean, this is really the kind of where a lot of the apps, for instance, a lot of bad guys. And when I started on the job, we'd listen to people's telephones all the time, you know, listen to their wire intercepts. Nowadays, they're on these apps, the chat apps and things like that, which is presents some unique technological problems for us. So it's just a different world. And if AI is anything like what they some people predict, then yeah, it'll be a challenge for law enforcement and it'll be a boon to criminals. If you can create fake identities and if you can bring big data to bear on what you're doing, then yeah, I think it'll present a problem.
All right, that was great. But now it's time for a special segment on the show where we spin the wheel. On the wheel are seven possible categories, including a few new ones I brought out just for tonight's show. Wherever it lands is what you get. And the categories are apocalypse, known unknowns, music lover, friend or foe, quantum leap, desperately dreaming Dexter, and kick him in the junk. All right, you ready to take a spin?
Absolutely.
All right, here we go. Where she's round and round, where she stops, nobody knows. And you got, again, this always comes up. I don't know why. Music lover. Okay, wow. This the wheel loves it. What song or piece of music do you love, no matter how many times you hear it?
That would be Jerry Rafferty's Baker Street.
Oh, okay, right on.
Which I've actually, it took me three novels to get it name checked in one of my books, but I finally did. And it's you talk about how I grew up, right? Well, you know, my mom used to take me to the public pool all the time here in Kentucky. And I can remember one summer, being at that pool and that song being on like constant rotation on the big, speakers above the pool. That the minute I hear that song, it takes me back to being probably, you know, 10 years old, 11 years old, whatever it was, takes me back to summer. You know, if you ask any of my family and friends, if they say I had one favorite song, it would be Baker Street by Jerry Rafferty. So that is it.
Right on. All right. Very good. Okay. So now you're going to pick your poison. I've got three choices for you. I'm not going to tell you what's behind each. We'll get to as many as we can, depending on time. A, B, or C, just pick one.
C.
C. All right. So C is never forget your first. All right. So what was the first full-length book you wrote? How did you feel about it then? How do you feel about it now in hindsight? And what, if anything, would you tell your younger author self that would have better helped you prepare for the writer life ahead?
First full-length book that I wrote, and I assume we're not talking about a book I wrote when I was like 10 or 12. So
no, as an adult.
As an adult. It was not long after the NaNoWriMo competition. It was a crime novel, and it was called Taiga, T-A-I-G-A. I loved that book. And when I wrote that book, I knew it wasn't quite publishable, but I read that book and thought that the guy who wrote this may actually be able to write more books like this. And I would probably go back and tell that younger me that, you know, maybe you should have started 5 years earlier than 5 years earlier than you did.
All right. Fair enough. All right. So pick one. You got A or B?
Let's go with A.
A. All right. Energy booster. The writer's life is a challenge no matter where you are in your career. So as an author, what gives you the critical energy boost you need to help you be at your best or overcome the inevitable setbacks, roadblocks, and disappointments you encounter?
You know, actually for me, it's a really good day of writing. If I can get a good day in and feel good about what I have written, then that can power me through, you know, 3 to 5 really shitty days where I feel like I've got no traction at all. So a good writing day where I can look back on a page or a paragraph or even a sentence and say, I got that one right. Then that is all about all the boost I need to get me going.
No joke, right? A good day goes a long way, right?
Exactly.
All right, great. All right. So now what we're going to do is we're going to go to our advice column.
All
right. So what's the best and worst writing advice you've ever been given?
You know, I think the worst writing advice is write what you know. I mean, that's kind of hackneyed and cliched. I mean, obviously my first few books were about crime and stuff, but you know, I think what you want to write is you want to write what you want to know, right? I mean, to me, books are, when I sit down to write a book, they're questions. They're things that I'm curious about or that interest me, even if they're not a topic that I know anything about. I wasn't in a cult, but I wrote a book about a cult, right? So it's not right what you know, it's right what you want to know. And, and that'll give you the passion. So it's a, that's a advice you hear all the time, but I don't think it's really all that true. I think the best advice I was given, or I think I've come across, is find your process. You know, for me, a big part of finally breaking through, I'm not talking about being published, but just talking about getting books done, getting novel length works done, was finding the process that works for me. And, you know, one thing authors always do is ask other authors, well, how, you know, what's your process, right? Are you a plotter? Are you a pantser? Do you get up right every day? Are you not right every day? I don't really think it matters. And I think telling somebody there's only one way to do it is, again, more crappy advice.
Totally.
But I think figuring it out and taking the time to discover what your process is the best advice to being able to kind of do this long term.
All right, great. So now it's time for you to get some truth serum. I'm going to ask you 10 questions. You ready?
All right.
All right. Favorite flavor ice cream?
Banana.
Oh, okay. That's a new one on the show. What's one food you will never eat ever for any reason?
Tuna fish.
Okay, fair enough. All right, bucket list destination anywhere in the world?
Probably Ireland.
Okay. If you could have one superpower, what would it be?
A mutant healing factor like Wolverine.
Oh, okay. No one's ever said that one before. I like that one. Okay. Do you play any musical instruments? And if not, which one if you could?
I do play musical instruments, but I don't play them very well, but I do play.
What do you play?
I have a guitar back there. I play keyboards. I play, growing up, I played clarinet, drums, played a bunch of stuff. So,
all right, fair enough. All right. We'll have to, after the show, we'll have to jam out. All right. Cats or dogs?
Growing up and for many years, cats, now dogs.
All right. Same here. Favorite cocktail. If you don't drink, your favorite beverage to unwind.
I like a very good old fashioned.
Okay, good on you. All right, you can see a live performance, sports, music, theater, whatever, any seat, any venue, any time in history. What's your choice?
Wow, that is a tough one. You know what? Wow. You know, I might have liked to have seen maybe real early the very first iterations of like Led Zeppelin or the Eagles or somebody like that, you know, front row, small club, you know, just starting out sort of stuff.
All right.
Maybe the Eagles, I would have liked to do that.
All right, cool, on you. All right, if you could get a continuation of any canceled TV show ever, what would it be?
I like Homicide: Life on the Streets.
Oh, yes.
I thought that was a very great show. Okay. And then more recently, there was a series, I can't remember if it was on HBO Showtime, Mindhunter. That was very good.
So. Oh, yes. Actually, I've had Mark Olshaker, who co-wrote the book. It's been on the show a couple of times. We kind of dug into it. Yes.
Yeah.
We're going to get into that at the end, I think. All right. So we got a couple of minutes to take some questions from the audience. So I got a couple here. So Todd, what is the most unique diversionary tactic drug smugglers use?
Well, they're creative and they have a lot of resources. There's no doubt about that. I mean, I've seen drugs hidden in about every type of container, vessel, ship, plane. I will say something interesting I saw in Haiti, which is these were vessels that were coming in from the Guajira Peninsula of Colombia, and they would attach these kind of parasites or bladders to the outside of the ship below the waterline. And the only way you could access them was with scuba gear. And so these boats would be bobbing around in the harbors in Haiti. And, you know, Haitians would be going about their business and they would look out and they'd see all these bubbles around these boats. And then sure enough, these scuba divers would appear walking up the beach, dragging bundles of cocaine that had been strapped to the sides of these vessels. It was a weird experience for both the, you know, scuba divers and for the Haitians there. So, you know, I've definitely seen that. And then I've also, you know, body carriers. You know, I've seen people carry drugs strapped to their bodies, about every way you can strap drugs and swallow drugs. So those are some of the more interesting and unpleasant tactics that I've seen.
All right. So another one. Do the agents today come from college or from other agencies?
Both. I mean, DEA is really trying to kind of broaden, you know, traditionally it's a lot of guys who former military, former cops, but nowadays we need a broad skill set. And you don't have to have a college degree, but it helps, you know, a life experience, work experience matters. We're looking for people with accounting degrees and technological backgrounds, financial backgrounds, languages, or, you know, anyone who can speak languages is somebody that we're going to take a look at. So, you know, there is no one size fits all agent. We all come from a vast variety of backgrounds.
Right. Okay. Just real quick. I'm gonna assume yes. But did you watch Justified?
Yes, I have watched Justified.
So what do you? I mean, you know, Raylan Givens doesn't seem to fit exactly the mold that you're talking about as real. What did you think about the show?
No, but it was tremendously well written, tremendously well acted, and you can forgive a lot of things if you're telling a great story. But great stuff. No, it's a great show.
Okay, and it's coming back real soon.
That's right.
All right, great. So I'm gonna share my screen, and we're gonna share some good stuff here. So everyone, hang on one second. Share my screen. What do we got here? All right. So Todd, what are we looking at here? Talk to me.
So The Flock was the book that came out last year, and it is kind of a apocalyptic thriller with a little bit of horror elements. You know, I'd written, this was my fifth published book. I had four out before that, a trilogy set out west, the kind of the Big Ben trilogy, which is kind of a neo-Western about drug cartels and things like that. And then Lost River, which was a book about kind of the opioid crisis a little bit, but more about a small town in crisis. And it was actually set here in Kentucky before I moved back here. But those were more traditional crime novels. And I really wanted to write had long wanted to write a book about a flock. I mean, about a cult. Kind of wanted to tell it in a unique way. And so this book is about a cult, a woman who survived a cult. It takes place. The A narrative takes place kind of 10 years after the cult has disbanded in kind of a fiery apocalypse, not unlike what happened at Waco. Right. And now some of the predictions of the cult have started to come true. Birds falling from the sky. You know, weather events and all sorts of kind of predictions. And so this is a woman who's escaped the cult and, you know, has wanted to kind of deny some of the things she learned, but she can't. And the cult maybe is starting to reform. She has a young daughter who has a lot of interest from these new version of the cult members. So it's a kind of a mixture of a dystopian novel and a horror novel a little bit with a lot of crime. Kind of crime and FBI and investigative stuff in it. And a lot of the book has these kind of epistolary pieces, FBI reports, police reports, coroner's reports, magazine articles, all this kind of material that goes back and forth in time, kind of filling in the backstory of this cult that I thought in kind of a unique way. Right. Drawing on the sort of, in a way, it's like an investigation. So it kind of draws on the sort of investigations that I would put together.
Okay.
The reader can kind of pick through all these clues, see who's telling the truth, and see how the media and various people who had an interest in this cult kind of portrayed their version of it or their view of it.
All right. Wow. That sounds amazing. So everyone, buy this book. I know it's next on my list. Absolutely. All right. So since we're talking about, we got crime, dystopian fiction. As for me, And this actually just, my cover reveal just came out today. This is the fourth book in my Angela Hardwick series, Blunt Force Rising. I just announced this cover a few hours ago. So this is, as I said, the fourth book in my ongoing series featuring hard-boiled private eye Angela Hardwick. In my mind, she's part Blade Runner, part Doctor Who, part Atomic Blonde. In Blunt Force Rising, Hardwick and her partner, Eric Whistler, are providing security on a galaxy cruise ship for an AI, robotics, and cybernetics conference. But that event quickly devolves into a bitter fight between the pro-android and anti-android community when a murder takes place on board, and it sets off a chain of events kind of more horrific than even Hardwick has ever seen. And when all is said and done, I think it's safe to say that Hardwick and Whistler will never be the same. Blunt Force Rising is actually a new one for me for two reasons. One, it's the first full-length novel that I've written that's a single-setting, closed-room murder mystery, which was a lot more challenging than I thought it was going to. I thought it was going to be tough, but it was real tough. And then two, it's actually my stab at novel length at some horror. As a friend of mine says, you know, I'm not really a horror author as much as an author who writes some horror, but it's all kind of blended in there. Blunt Force Rising will be on sale in September. So look out for some announcements for some pre-sales. And I hope you guys dig it. And in the meantime, I'll encourage you to check out the first three books in the series, Crackling Fire, Fractured Lives, and Hot Ash, which are all available on Amazon and published by Crazy Eight Press. Okay, so that's our show. I want to thank my guest, J. Todd Scott, for coming on tonight. And I want to thank everyone who's watching at home. And as always, be gentle, be kind, be gracious, and go read a book. And I'll see you all next week.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it.
All right. Thanks for coming on. It was fantastic. All right, everyone. Thanks a lot. And I'll see you soon. Bye now.